All right, and welcome to another episode of the Jumping the Rail podcast here on the JTR Podcast Network. This is Mark Rebin coming to you from the Noodles position in Champaign, Illinois. I'm joined by Minderz. She's back after a week off.
I'm back.
Did you miss us, Minderz?
Of course I did.
Wasn't the same without you.
You know, I've heard that a lot about this week's events, so...
Yeah, you just had a wrestling-free week almost.
You missed
0-1 on Saturday.
Right. It was a wrestling-free week, but believe me, I was wondering what was going on. And Well, you guys know. I was in your guys' chat all the time, so.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Also joining us right now, we have our buddy from the Fantasy Draft Crew, AJ Mifflin. AJ, I made you do some homework that we're going to get into a little bit later on. And
I'm prepared.
Yes. Wow. Then Bari is going to be joining us eventually. I'm not sure what time yet. He said he's planning on jumping in. But hello, Dwayne. I see Dwayne's in the chat already.
Sorry, I'll jump back here in a minute. I've got you guys on. I just forgot to correct my note.
We got a little guest star over here.
Okay. Ah, okay.
All right. So, a lot to go into. I sent you our list, Minderz, and there's not a lot of stuff on our list for this week, but I think there's plenty of meat on the bone, as it were.
Putting the clown face paint on him, that's kind of like putting a hat on a hat, don't you think?
A little bit. But, Minderz, real quick, at the start here, we had the little tribute at the beginning. Aki Bono passed away last week. For those that remember, he was the guy in the sumo match with the Big Show. I almost said Andre the Giant because I was reading a book earlier. But, he was, I'm trying to remember how old he was, I want to say he was in his 50s, because of course I didn't remember any of this stuff.
There we go. 69 to 24.
So mid-50s. So didn't strike me as a Chadwick when I saw his real name, but you know,
yeah. Not at all.
Dwayne, don't get ahead of me. He's
jumping ahead.
So the. First things first, we gotta do our usual here, Minderz. So I hope you're ready to get your brain teased here.
Oh no, here we go.
Okay,
hold on.
All right, so this is becoming one of my favorite segments on the show here, Minderz. So,
I'm sure it is.
So name that wrestler, and I'll start off by telling you this is a current wrestler. I won't tell you what show, but are you ready?
Okay.
All right, here we go.
Sorry, trying to picture him with either short or no hair. Trying to figure this out. What was that?
I don't know.
That was my phone. I forgot to put it on silent.
AJ, chime in. Oh, Adam Cole. Thanks, Bari.
Bari got it before you did, Minderz.
He did.
Yeah, I had it wrong too. I was gonna say Punk. I was just picturing him with like some facial hair, and I was like Punk, but then no.
No, that was last. That was 2 weeks ago.
No, that is a more ripped and chiseled Adam Cole than we've seen lately.
Who's Adam Cole? Didn't recognize
the muscle mass.
That's a typo, Minderz.
Oh, typo. Okay.
All right. So yes, Adam Cole is our mystery wrestler this week. And, speaking of story time with Adam Cole, I have something I've been itching to share with our audience. Because When we watched the main event of WrestleMania Night 2, it brought to mind a story from my youth, just with the way the match was booked, you know, all the fuckery and whatnot. And I went digging, and I found this.
I had that.
Wow.
Hulk Hogan wins the belt. Yes. Unfortunately, I had to find this on eBay because I mean, my copy is long gone. But I was kind of bummed there were no stickers in it. It says right there, 12 stickers.
What a ripoff.
Well, this book has seen better days, though. It's very bent up and all that stuff. But I thought it would be fun to take a stroll down memory lane here. I want to read this to our public because you'll see a lot of similarities to the booking of the Cody Roman WrestleMania main event.
Okay.
And then also, and after I'm done with this, we're going to talk about it because I have issues.
You have issues. Okay.
I have issues. All right. So here we go. And I had to fudge some of the pictures because I couldn't find them online. All right. I'll never forget that night, kids. It was January 24th, 1984 at Madison Square Garden in New York City. As I moved toward the ring, Eye of the Tiger blasted and Hulkamaniac screamed my name. On the one side, I saw all the good guy wrestlers cheering me on, fist in the air. Then in the other corner, I saw them, the bad boys of wrestling. They were all huddled together trying to come up with a plan to defeat me and keep the championship belt. They moved away and I saw him, the meanest of all wrestlers. The Iron Sheik was climbing into the ring, waving an Iranian flag over his head, taunting me. I felt like rolling him up in that flag and mailing him back to Iran. But I wanted to win the championship belt fair and square. I wasn't going to resort to underhanded tricks. Sorry, I had to laugh.
Sure you were.
Just then, I felt an elbow smashing me from outside the ring. Now, I'm going to pause for a second. We did a watch-along of this match about 2 months ago. I'm just gonna stop there. It was a blow from the Iron Sheik's brutal Russian friend Nikolai Volkov. I turned to the referee who made Volkov get away from the ring. So the huge Russian wrestler who thinks that Americans are too weak wanted to play dirty. The referee was starting the match now. I had to forget about Volkov. But then I saw the Iron Sheik motion to another friend. Mr. Fuji is the sneakiest wrestler in the World Wrestling Federation, but his bad buddies always mess up his schemes. He thinks he's tough, but he couldn't karate chop his way out of a bread factory. I put the Sheik in a body spin and took him down to the campus. About a bread factory.
A bread
couldn't
factory.
Chop his way out of
okay.
a bread factory. That's a sick burn right there. All right, I put the Sheik in a body spin and took him down to the canvas. As we rolled toward the ropes, I felt something blind my eyes. It was Mr. Fuji's volcanic Fuji dust. Never heard it called that before. Just then, I heard the sound of bagpipes.
Oh.
When I saw Rowdy Roddy Piper, I felt like telling him to take his Scottish skirt and bagpipes and get lost. My eyes were beginning to clear, and I saw Piper making fun of me outside the ring. Ever since he smashed a rock and roll record over Captain Lou Albano's head, I've been mad at him. Then I heard someone else screaming. I need to point out, this is a book made for children. I want to make sure that that's clear.
Yeah, I'm noticing.
This is just great. Here I am trying to keep my mind on the Sheik and Big John Studs heckling me from the crowd. Big John distracted me and that gave the Sheik the chance he needed. Before I could react, the Iron Sheik threw me to the mat. He tried to get me into his horrible camel clutch hold. No one had ever gotten out of it yet. And that's when I heard my friend, the big guy, yell. Whoever could this be?
Whoever could this be?
Talk about your big boys. Yes. Andre the Giant is 7'5" and weighs 500 pounds. Just hearing his voice made me feel better. The good guys were coming to my rescue. Andre is shy and nice, but when he's mad, he's nothing to sneeze at. That's when I heard the rock music. Let's get to specify rock music.
Ah. Yes. There he is.
Captain Lou Albano was making fists at the Iron Sheik and cheering with all the other Hulkamaniacs to get me moving. I heard and felt the rock and wrestling connection. I couldn't let the Iron Sheik keep the belt. The Iron Sheik kept trying to put his camel clutch hold on me, but I was holding him off. That's when I heard a dog howling. I'm trying to swallow all this this text here.
There we go.
If I wasn't a dog lover before, if I wasn't a dog lover before, I was now. The Junkyard Dogs theme song, Another One Bites the Dust, filled the arena. The JYD was dancing in the aisles with a couple of Hulkamaniacs. Okay, you're gonna love this. Suddenly, the JYD started barking his head off and running around in circles. Dot, dot, dot. Rowdy Roddy Piper had brought a cat into the arena.
Oh, shit.
JYD goes crazy when he sees one. This poor sap that wrote this doesn't know that he's not an actual dog, right?
Well, let's hope. Let's hope.
Yeah. All right. I was sure glad to see Hillbilly Jim. He took the cat away from Rowdy Roddy and was sitting there playing with it. Sometimes I think Hillbilly Jim should have stayed on the farm, but he took to wrestling quick enough. One night a bunch of bad guys were trying to cut my hair when Hillbilly jumped in and saved me. I guess they only got him on the top. I needed to keep my mind on the match now. The Iron Sheik was getting me into his camel clutch, and that's when I saw the Superfly. The Superfly had landed. He came flying down from the rafters with a whoomp. And that's when I knew for sure I could get out of the Iron Sheik's camel clutch hold. I keep calling it a hold, like it's they get to specify. All my friends had come tonight to give me their support. The good guys were going to win. I heaved the Iron Sheik into the ropes. Then I flipped him as he flew off the ropes. But that's just sloppy writing. I clamped on a headlock so tight every vein in my neck bulged. And at last I pinned him. The referee got worried that I'd get too carried away. He declared me the champ. Then we finish with the last page. I had won the championship belt. All my friends, the good guys, were going wild. The bad guys of wrestling had been defeated. All the months of hard work, exercise, pumping iron, and eating right had finally paid off. He didn't mention the prayers. I was the World Wrestling Federation heavyweight champion. If you eat right, exercise, and get plenty of rest, you can be a champion too, in whatever you do. And if you want to see the Rock and Wrestling Connection in action, you can watch me and all the other WWF superstars on TV. Or if you can, come cheer us on in person when we're in your town. That's just shameless.
That's shameless.
Okay. So that's the end of the book. It's not a long one.
No.
Stacey, how many dang people were in this match? We did the watch along, and I think the answer is none. This is not how that match happened.
Nope.
which is pretty par for the course for Hulk Hogan telling a story, though.
That's very true.
Surprised he didn't throw something about the international dateline in there.
Right, he wrestled four matches that day.
Yeah.
This book was written by a man named Dan Stain, STAIN. Must be Russo's cousin.
Must be.
Yeah, this is from 1985. Okay, he says January 24th, 1984. That's wrong. It was the 23rd. And he should have done his research. A couple questions here. Number one, why is Big John Studd in the crowd?
I wondered that. That kind of caught me off guard.
Yeah, it says Big John Studd's heckling me from the crowd. He could have gotten... He works there. He doesn't have to get go in the crowd. I've read this book like three times since I got it in the mail after WrestleMania. I'm still trying to wrap my head around Roddy Piper with a cat.
Right? And then Hillbilly Jim sitting there playing with it.
Yeah.
Why'd they have to do Junkyard Dog like that, though?
Yeah, I know. It's like, is he trying to convince the children that JYD is an actual dog? It's kind of ridiculous.
Yeah.
Oh my God. And it kind of made Hillbilly seem like an idiot too, just sitting there playing with a cat instead of. The thing that really got me, I heaved the Iron Sheik into the ropes and I clamped on a headlock so tight every vein in my neck bulged. He did not win this match with a headlock.
No.
And you don't get a pin from a headlock. It would have been a submission. I'm sorry, but yeah, this book, as entertaining as it is when you're 5 or 6 years old, which is how old I was when I read it, is rife with inaccuracies and hyperbole.
The biggest part of that is you're supposed to take your vitamins, say your prayers, and get sleep.
Now, they didn't mention the prayers. I think they were told to kind of keep that in church.
I thought they did on the last. They didn't at the end?
Let me look. Eat right, exercise, and get plenty of rest. Oh, so you got to make sure you sleep.
Okay.
So make sure you don't stay up past your bedtime.
Well, crap. Okay.
So to the Antioch Publishing Company in Yellow Springs, Ohio. By the way, $1.95 in the U.S. and $2.50 in Canada for this book when it came out.
Of course it was. Of course it
was.
You
said where? Yellow Springs, Ohio?
Yellow Springs, Ohio.
Yeah, that town is basically a hippie commune. I guarantee somebody was high as hell when they wrote that.
Somebody took their vitamins before the.
Somebody took some vitamins.
They took something.
They took something. So yeah,
I just said vitamins.
But this kind of has all the booking of a Bloodline rules match. If you read it.
It does.
That's, and my brother asked me about the booking of that main event, and I told him the first thing I thought of was that book, and he said, "Me too." natural cat as in meow meow. I think that's where they're going with that.
Ernie Miller, they were trying to say. To use him for it.
Ernest Miller, yeah, he had to call his mama. But yeah, I wanted to get this out of the way. I tried to have this in time for last week's episode, but it didn't get there until like Wednesday. But
you could have read it on the other podcast. That would have been fun.
It wouldn't have been germane. That was 0-1 business. But that's it. Hulk Hogan Wins the Belt is the name of the book by Dan Spain. The day the Hulkster beat the Iron Sheik. It says they spoiled the ending right there on the cover of the book. And again, no stickers, so I call bullshit. All right, so enough of story time. I'm going to put that over there out of my
But we missed story time with Redman. Come on now.
Hey, if you find any more like kids' books from back in the old days, get them to me, and I'll read them, and I'll critique them just thusly.
I had a coloring book, too, when I was...
I had a sticker book. I had, like, the big, like, it was like a coloring book, but you buy stickers at the grocery store, like, where the baseball cards were, and you'd fill it in.
I remember those, too, yep.
Oh, those were my favorite. I like those better than coloring books. Because I'd have them for baseball, football, wrestling, all that stuff.
Oh, I'm sure.
All right. So anyway, all the fun aside here, it's time to get to our Hoots and Judies of the week. And Turbo does not qualify as a Judy, even though she's very cute. I don't know where
I'm interested
is.
To see who you guys have.
Well,
because you guys got to see more wrestling this week than I did, so.
Yeah, I think you're going to be surprised by mine. Stacy says hi, Turbo AJ. So.
Nah.
Hey there, Turbo.
All right. She's trying to compete with Noodles chilling. For cutest cat on the show.
She loves the camera this time, it seems.
Yeah. So I'm in the Noodles position. Does that mean that AJ's in the Turbo position?
Yep.
And I'm in the sugar position.
Wow, wait a minute.
That sounds wrong. That sounds a little bad.
I don't like the sound of that. Shut up, Stacy. I hear you back there.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, boy.
Oh, she's dying back there.
Oh, I know she is. I heard her cackle a minute ago.
Amanda's heard you cackling back there. All right.
It's so weird now, like seeing you at Noodles' position and knowing what your apartment looks like now, and knowing just how small
I was thinking the same thing.
Hey, it's kind of the same thing with me and AJ because I just saw your place for the first time a few weeks ago too.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh my goodness!
Everybody always sees my place because everybody has to use the bathroom whenever.
I mainly go. I want to pet the dog. That's my main.
Well, that's true. You want a pet sugar.
I'm going to win her over. I'm going to
win
her
over
days. Eventually.
Well, your place is kind of like in the perfect pit stop amount of distance driving to get to these wrestling things. So
Yeah,
I know.
Oh, we realized that Saturday driving to Terre Haute from my house.
Oh,
yeah,
I
want to stretch my legs, but I'm not going to say anything.
Yeah. Oh, you should have said something. All right. Anyway, we're getting off track here.
So from now on, just stop.
All right. Good hoot of the week. I'm going to, Minderz, do you want to go first or do you want to wait and see what we have?
I want to wait and see what you guys say.
All right. Well, AJ, how about you go first then?
My good hoot of the week is Chad Gable.
Ooh, that's a good call.
Because he's had enough of the bullshit. He wants that belt, and now he's got a little fire in him, and now he's pissed off and determined, and I'm here for it.
Oh, yeah. Dude, everything about that match last night was awesome, from Sammy's entrance all the way to the end when Chad jumped him on the floor.
I don't think it's possible for Chad Gable to have a bad match, honestly.
I don't think so. I had one thing that I would have done differently, and I know, smarty wrestling fan. I would have had Sammy get the three off of the roll through when he was in the ankle lock and just catch Gable by surprise.
Yep, I agree.
Because that'd really piss him off.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it?
Because that would be like two times in a row if he had did it like that.
Yeah, but this time his shoulders would be down.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm kind of going to need Gable to bring that up about how it should have been him and Gunther now that he's a heel.
Oh, yeah. Obviously, no Gunther last night because I don't think he's still allowed to leave the country until he gets his visa status.
That's what I wondered. I wondered if that was... Oh, Dwayne, you've never seen anything with American Alpha. They are excellent heels. It'll be fine. He will be fine.
Yeah, don't... I don't think we're getting cartoony shoosh boy heel out of Gable this time
around. I think we're getting American, like, Alpha.
We're getting angle heel out of this.
Yes, we are. Getting
when he was the wrestling machine.
Yes.
I'm here for it.
Oh, heck yeah.
I am too.
So that's your good hoot is Chad Gable. That's a good one. You're going to be surprised. My good hoot, I'm actually going to give it to Jon Moxley this week. I got a buddy that was at that show in Chicago on Friday. He said it was a lot of fun and it was a good match. And Moxley, I guess, is the first guy to hold the WWE, AEW, and New Japan world titles at this point. So congratulations to him. Stacy's so glad Shush is over. It is for Gable. I don't know. Is it possible
they're
that Otis keeps it?
They're still doing it down at NXT right now.
Oh.
It's still that entrance music. Yeah, it's annoying.
They need to shoosh with it.
Yeah, they do.
All right. So I got Mox for mine. Minderz, no more Stalin. Yeah.
That's okay. I'm going to go CM Punk for my good hoot of the week. I mean, it's not very often that you're the most popular person on both major wrestling companies in one week. So I'm going to go Punk.
This is true. Oh my goodness.
Sorry, couldn't help it. I did have an honorable mention, and this is only because of what I heard from you guys. I almost thought about putting Benjamin Trust in just for stepping up over the weekend. So
He did step up. He killed a Pokemon card or two at his table, apparently.
I heard that, and I heard it was a very rare one.
Yeah, Trust, he cares not for knickknacks. He
cares
and
not.
Things. Also, honorary good hoot goes to our buddy Lincoln for roasting D.A. Malkin on more than one occasion during the show Saturday. If David's listening, you got to pass that on to Lincoln.
That's my
buddy. That
was
great.
We got to get Lincoln a good hoot shirt.
We'll have to look in. Do you have it as kid size?
No, but I think we can make it. We can arrange it. Scott Harden's in the chat, so he's going to...
It was him that got his card ripped.
Yeah, it was a Charizard. I'm going to butcher this. A Charizard card? It rhymes.
I think you said that right.
Okay.
I think it is Charizard.
Is that from some sort of anime or Pokemon?
Pokemon.
Okay. Good to know. All right. Well, let's move on to our good Judy of the week here. And, yeah, it was Scott's son's card. But
Yeah.
All right, so good Judy of the Week. I'm going to start on this one. I gave my good Judy of the Week to Chelsea Green because, man, she put the work in. She was getting herself over. She just her selling when she wrestled Jade last week, even though it was like a minute long, was just superb. I thought she did good. Then I guess they had a tag match on SmackDown that I missed. It was her and Piper against Bianca and Jade, but I hear it was more of the same from her there.
Oh, I saw that. Yeah, it was.
And then apparently she told Ava to get her the hell out of there. So apparently she's trying to get away from Adam Pearce and Nick Aldis.
Yeah, she
So
wants away from Aldis and Pierce, so.
Chelsea, I mean, her character is really annoying, but I'm all for it because she does it so well.
Yes.
So that's just where I'm at on that.
I just hate that Piper's tied with her.
Yeah, Piper needs to be doing her own thing.
Yeah, she
With the
does.
draft,
I'd
though.
kind of love if Piper won the vacant belt, and we got some good Lady Hoss matches out of it.
Yeah, we'll
Yeah,
talk
I do
about that
enjoy
here
it.
in a minute because I'm scared, honestly.
Yeah, Stacy's chiming in. She has great facial expressions talking about Chelsea. And she really does.
Yeah.
Oh, Dwayne. Yeah, Dwayne found out Jade is using her real name. That's true.
Yep, that is her real name.
I checked that out when she was still in AEW, and sure enough, that's her name. Dwayne, I don't know if you're a baseball fan. She's married to Brandon Phillips, the old infielder from the Reds and the White Sox. But that doesn't really matter to a lot of wrestling fans. But I don't care because I like
Nope,
baseball.
sorry, I don't watch a whole lot of baseball.
That's all good. All right, so I'm trying to put off the AEW talk until we get Bari in here, because
Are the rest of us
it's.
going to get a pick, Judy's? Because right now you're the only one that did.
Oh yeah. I'm just I'm meandering a bit. I'm still all wound up from this damn book. So
Inaccurate publishing really grinds your gears, huh?
it shoddy research just bothers me, especially about something as simple as this. Like, you just have to go watch the match. But I think that
You
book's gonna have to go
know
to my brother after this.
what? If we go ahead and finish up our good Judys, then why don't we go ahead and do our flashback? And that'll kill some time.
Bari says, give me 15. So
Okay.
we got about 15. So I think we have time to do that. So let's finish our
We can kill
Judys here.
15 minutes.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
All right. AJ, your good Judy of the
I was
week.
looking.
Well, I tend to make my picks for good hoots and Judys. Normally at the end of a long and dominant reign of a champion, much like I did with Gunther this past couple weeks. So I'm just going to keep with that, and I'm going to say Rhea Ripley is my good Judy of the
Damn you.
week. And I also kind of loved how she said, I'm not just going to be out for an injury. If I see Liv Morgan in the back, I'm going to go to jail tonight.
It's on site, as they say. I think
Yeah.
that's what the kids say.
Yep.
Yeah. Standing on business and what have you.
Yes. We're gonna get to that here eventually, but yeah, that news broke yesterday afternoon that Rhea was gonna have to vacate the championship, which sucks. You hate seeing somebody have to do that without actually losing the title. It seems like Liv is gonna settle right into being a heel from that cut the promo she did afterwards.
Yeah,
I
I
mean, people
agree.
were already cheering for Rhea anyway, but when she comes back from this injury, she is going to get a huge pop.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Like, she'll be a babyface no matter what she does.
What's
Definitely.
kind of
And
worrying me is she's kind of fallen into that John Cena category where no matter what, she's going to be babyface.
that's
Yeah.
that is
Cena
well,
always kind of.
I think
Cena
she could
had
get
always
it.
had the crowd split, though. There was always the John Cena sucks, let's go Cena, Cena sucks. It was always
Yeah.
kind of split in the reaction. He was just constantly pushed as a baby face. Rhea's been, her like gimmick has always been pretty consistent, and it's just people will
Yeah.
not boo her, is what it is.
It's Steve Austin.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
Well, they tried to make him a heel, but it just did not take.
Did not take.
Or Becky during the Man run. She was originally supposed to be a heel, but then got behind her anyway.
Yep. For some reason, we all like kind of the unique people that want to tell everybody what to do. You want to tell off your boss? We're going to tell off your boss. You want to tell off somebody else? Okay, well, let's do that. You know?
I wish I could do that at work.
So, my good Judy, since we're going with ones that won't be back for a while, I think I'm going to go with Miss Becky. Because rumor has it, Seth won't stay off ever, so she's pregnant again.
Okay, we did a little digging on that. Apparently, Stacy says that article was from the first pregnancy.
Oh, it was from the first one.
Right. So I don't think she has a bun in the oven at this point. But they are taking time off, though, I think, to work out contracts.
I didn't even get to get my another great wrestler out of action because Seth Rollins is unsafe joke in.
Well, I know both their contracts are coming up. So that was theirs and somebody else's.
Drew,
that's it.
I think only has like a month or so left on it too.
If Drew leaves now, he's stupid.
They gotta at least get him locked in for the rest of the year so he can do some business with Punk.
Mm-hmm. At least.
Especially with Clash at the Castle being in Glasgow.
Yeah. And right now he's the best heel they got. So.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, I was reading the chat. You might not want to put that one up.
Dwayne says, was it Edge or Kurt Angle that started Cena sucks? Edge started Angle sucks. He started the you suck
Edge
business.
Started Angle. Yeah, because that
Cena
was...
sucks, I think, was just organic from the fans.
Yeah. I was going to say, because Reb, you and I were there for when Edge started the
t-shirt.
Angle sucks. Yeah.
The you suck t-shirt.
The you suck t-shirt.
Classic.
It was great.
All right. Yes.
Because it was offered in sizes, 2, 3, and 4X? Because they couldn't write it small enough to go on anything smaller.
Well, no, that was the original Angle. That was the Angle shirt with all the accomplishments. But when they unveiled it, Ed switched it with the You Suck shirt.
Yeah. Yeah. That was great.
Yeah. All right. So let's, we got a few minutes before we're going to get Bari. So why don't we jump into our flashback here real quick? So, and I've got graphics.
Here we go.
Because, of course, I had to use the baseball game of the week music from the 80s.
I've noticed.
Because it is catchy. Makes me think of Vin Scully. All right, anyway. So this week, we are going to be talking about I was going for the April 85 issue, also, you know, because that's around the time this book came out. But they didn't have an April issue. They had spring of 1985 was the issue that they had.
Okay.
And, press time, it was basically covered October of 84. So it's a little farther reaching than like the usual ones are. Usually it's like about a 3-month gap, but this was a little bit more. So so looking at the cover here, we got Tommy Rich in there. You got how you can write to Mill Masters and save his career. Yeah, we did.
Tommy Rich is still fighting.
Yeah. And super nice guy too. Yep. I like this. How you can write to Mill Mascaris and save his career.
Save his career from what?
I don't know. I gotta get the issue now. Should Jimmy Snuka be given another WWF title shot?
Hmm.
Oh, he would have had to turn heel first.
True.
And I would have loved heel Snuka against Hogan.
Would have been fun.
Yeah. Bob Backlund's nightmare match against Jesse Ventura.
Shocker.
I don't know if that's because of Jesse's ability in the ring or Backlund got his ass kicked or what. There.
So here we go with our PWI that AJ's wasn't alive for when most of them were wrestling.
AJ was negative 12 years old, if my math is right, when this when this came out.
And what year is this again?
April of 85.
85? Yeah, I was negative 11 then.
So let's start, as we always do, with our overall top 10.
Okay.
So here we go. And some different faces than usual here. And
take down Tony before it gets put on top of somebody's body and looks ridiculous.
Like yours?
I'm keeping my happy. That's not any better.
That's even worse.
You need to take it down completely right now while we do. That's okay.
Oh, that's true.
But you need
that's
take, true. You need to take it down completely. Okay, okay, now we can okay. go.
All right, now we're cooking. All right, top 10. So here we go. Here's our top 10 for spring of 85. So we got Ric Flair, number one. Rick Martel, number two. Dusty Rhodes, number three. Hogan, four, which really surprised me that Hogan would be down at number four here.
This is what, 85?
Well, October of 84. But he was world champ at the time. Hulkamania was cooking. Okay. Kerry Von Erich is five. Andre, number six. Wahoo McDaniel, seven. The Boss, Magnum T.A., and his chest hair is number seven. Eight. Eight. Greg the Hammer Valentine, nine. And Rick Steamboat is number 10. That's a pretty damn strong top 10.
Yeah.
It is.
There's not a weak link among them.
There really isn't. Well, unless you count Hogan.
Well.
And for the amount of money he was drawing at that time, I'm going to say no.
You mean very original true. Triple H?
Yeah, original Triple H. That was hilarious you guys brought that up today, because I, on Treasures, he talks about that. And I was like, oh yeah, because they did a NWO. They were going for looking for NWO, WCW stuff. So it
I
was
saw
like,
something they're looking for like singlets.
Well, they went, they found singlets from Nash. They ended up getting the black and white blood drip from Scott Hall.
Oh, his blood.
Well, yeah. And
it should have been a Valvinus vest.
And then, ew, damn it, Reb. Okay, anyway. And then they got Hogan's tights from when he came back to the WWF as the NWO.
Okay.
That was like the black, white tie-dye looking.
With the lightning
on. It was like tie-dye or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
And then they got the Steiner's Michigan jackets.
Nice.
And the chain head cover for Scott.
The chain mail, the headdress.
And then the headset or the headgear for Rick. Nice. And bronze in it. Bronze in it because he has all this stuff because he has it hidden in his room so his dad can't get a hold of it.
I just want to know how heavy that chain mail hat thing is. I want to try it on. I just want to know how heavy it is.
He had one on at the expo. He was wearing one. It was probably wasn't the original
the expo
one.
He was. No, because the original one is now traveling with WWE.
Yes, probably it was probably at WrestleMania
and
World.
It's not as long as the one that Rick usually wears, or that Scott usually wears.
Ah, I
gotcha. It was shorter. It only went to like bottom of their neck. So
okay, I got you. Maybe that was little PD Pump's headdress when he was in TNA.
Maybe.
Oh, it might have been.
I don't know. All right, so anyway, moving on here, let's get into tag teams here. Spring of 85, October 84. So I'll give you one guess who the top ranked tag team is on this list.
Legion of Doom.
I need you to be more specific.
More specific.
I need you to be more specific. The Legion of Doom was a stable back in the early 80s. They were not the tag team name.
Hawk and Animal.
There you go. The Road Warriors, number one.
Road Warriors. Okay, sorry.
Yes. Number two is Don Kernodle and Ivan Koloff, the NWA tag champs at the time. The Fabulous Ones, Steve Kern and Stan Lane, are number three. Adrian Adonis and Dick Murdoch, the WWF Tag Team Champions, are four. Rock and Roll Express are five. Midnight Express at six. The Long Riders, Black Bart and Ron Bass, are number seven. I don't know who this fella in the white is here, but it's Crusher Khrushchev and Jim Neidhart, or number eight. I'm not sure who this guy's supposed to be, but that's the only picture I can find of them together. That's on the right. That's Neidhart.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And that's Demolition Smash on the left.
Okay.
Wow.
Okay. All right. I had to piece together these last two because I couldn't find any pictures of them actually as a team. But Rip Rogers and Ted Oates are number 9. And King Kong Bundy and Ravishing Rick Rude were number 10.
Wow, that's quite a combination.
Probably doing most of the work in the ring out of that last team.
I would imagine. But Bundy's getting that 5 count.
Yep.
Heck yeah.
All right. Next up here. All right. Next up, we have most popular. There we go.
And this again, is where Hogan will move up, probably.
Yeah, but not as far as you think. Here we go. Dusty's number 1. Everybody loves Dusty.
Everyone loves Dusty.
Yes, Dusty. Bull of the woods, if you will, in public. But so you got Dusty, Hogan, Kerry, Martel are the top 4 they were on the top 10 list. Sergeant Slaughter, number 5. Magnum is number 6. Andre, 7. Then Barry Windham is number 8. Billy Jack Haynes is 9. And then this is something you're going to notice going forward. Ric Flair's number 10 in the most popular list here. And he was kind of, it kind of depended on what territory he was in, whether he was a face or a heel.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so keep that in mind as we get to our most hated list here. Dwayne, the Long Riders of the Irwin Brothers was a world-class group. Bass and Black Bart were in the Carolinas, but same name. So he's not wrong, but not quite right. All right, most hated. Now, remember what I said here. So here's our list.
Yep.
Number one, Chris Adams. This is after he turned on the Von Erichs, so everybody hated him. And I just noticed I don't have my light on. Just a second. Boom, there we go. All right, so Adams is number 1, Wahoo McDaniel number 2, Nikolai Volkoff 3, Piper 4, Tully Blanchard 5. That is Kevin Sullivan at number 6. He's got his war paint on there. Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert is number 7. Gino Hernandez number 8. Greg Valentine 9. And Flair is number 10 and hated also. So he's number 10 and most popular and most hated on this list.
You know what, though? There is a time where that crosses with most popular and most hated.
Oh,
because
yeah,
if you are the most hated, then lots of times you're pretty popular. So
that's true.
I see it. I can understand it.
But
takes some talent to be on both of those lists.
Very true.
It does.
I gotta say though, I'm surprised that no Iron Sheik on this list for most hated. I mean, Slaughter.
What would he have been doing right now?
Slaughter.
Hmm.
Dwayne's on the same wave as me. Iron Sheik isn't on this list. But yeah, he
are
was
you
in
two
the middle
sharing
of the stuff
a brain now?
Oh, I hope not. But no, Sheik was in the middle of doing the boot camp matches with Slaughter at this point, so he should have been on that list if you ask me.
Should have been.
Anyway, yeah. All right, WWF list here. There we go. And I've been working. You know how last time I had to put the champion right in the middle of the list so you didn't get a clear view of everybody?
Mm-hmm.
So I've worked it out where it's going to be a lot more organized. So here we go. Look at that. Put them right on top.
There you go. I see Sugar Bear.
Yeah, there we go. So Hogan, obviously, world champion. Number one is Valentine. He was the Intercontinental Champion at the time, so number one contender. Big John Studd, 2. Tito Santana, number 3. Piper, 4. Slaughter, 5. And there he is, Kamala, the Ugandan Giant, is number 6. JYD, 7. Ken Patera at 8. Snuka, 9. And then Jesse the Body is at number 10 there. So a very stout list of challengers for the Hulkster in that list.
Oh, yeah.
I'm trying to tell who this fella is in the chat. But
yeah, I have no idea.
Well, whoever it is, welcome. I'm sorry, I don't have
I'm pretty sure it might be a bot. But
it
know.
Might be. Sorry, just don't click on it.
Yeah, I'm not going to.
No. All right. And we're going to move on to the AWA. Here we go.
All righty.
All right. And here we go. Yeah,
that looks like a bot to me.
Yeah. Martel is here on the top as the world champion at the time. And then star number one, Nick Bockwinkel, former champion. Mr. Saito is number two. Tony I Heart Feet Atlas is number three. Brad Rangins, the Olympian, is number four. Jumpin' Jim Brunzel, number five. This is right before he went
Look
to
at him.
The
he
Killer
is
Bees.
Cut. Holy crap.
Never was the most handsome fella, but, you know,
no,
heck of a drop.
That's
kick.
Why he wore a mask with the Killer Bees.
Only to cause confusion.
I know. So they could pull the old twin Aruni.
Mask confusion, they called it.
Yep.
All right. Billy Robinson, the great shooter, number six. He's the guy that trained Shayna Baszler, for those that don't know. Jumbo Saruta, number seven. Big Crusher Blackwell's number eight. The living legend Larry Zbysko, nine. And then Steve-O, not the one from Jackass, but Steve-O is number 10.
The one from Jackass would have been like five right about now.
I'm not sure how old Steve-O is. But,
I'm on it.
All right.
I'm curious now.
Well, while you do that, let's bring up the NWA.
Okay.
There we go. And then here's our list here. Ric Flair's at the top as the world champion, of course. Then starting number one, you got world television champion, I believe, Dusty Rhodes at that point. Maybe not. That might have been still Tully. So we've got Dusty, Wahoo, Kerry Von Erich, Ron Garvin, Harley Race is your top five. Except for Wahoo, all of them were eventually world champions at one point or another. Pez Watley at number six. That shocked me. I love Pistol Pez, but I didn't think he was going to make this list. Handsome Half-Breed Gino Hernandez, number seven. Outlaw Ron Bass is number eight. I'm sorry, Cowboy Ron Bass at the time. He wasn't outlaw until he went to the WWF. Tully Blanchard, number nine. And Jesse Barr, that one kind of surprised me a little bit too, is number 10. If you remember,
Art Barr.
Anybody
else see the Harley Race? Sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, anybody that remembers Art Barr, who's Eddie Guerrero's old tag partner in AAA, that's his brother, Jesse Barr. Also, Jimmy Jack Funk. In future reference. Sorry, Minders, go ahead.
No, I was just asking if anybody saw the behind the scene or behind Dark Side of the Ring for Harley Race this past
I have
week.
Not yet. I heard it
good.
Was good, but I haven't seen it. Her Trevor Murdoch
it's
is all
good.
Over that one.
Oh, yeah. I can't wait. Dark Side's on tonight.
Oh, which one is this? Is it the Chris Cole one?
No, Chris Cole was 2 weeks ago.
Oh, okay.
Hold on, I'll find out.
Okay.
Well, and Steve-O is actually older than I thought he was, so he would have been about 11.
Okay.
So.
Makes sense. All right, well, while you're looking that up, Minders, let's go to the Mid-South list here for their top 10. Now, they don't have a champion at the top because they, and also World Class, by the way, are under the NWA at this point. So it'd be the same champion as, so it'd be Flair. So Mid-South top 10, number one is Magnum T.A., who I believe was the North American champion at the time. Terry Taylor, Butch Reed at three, Steve Dr. Death Williams at four. Hacksaw Duggan in an unsettling close-up is number five. Ted DiBiase, six. Hercules Hernandez, seven. Brickhouse Brown, who's a guy we don't mention a whole lot on this show, at number eight. The Exotic Adrian Street is number nine. And Sonny King is number 10. King and Brown both. I think Bill Watts was trying to keep that African American audience after Dog left, so he brought those guys in. But they didn't quite have the same staying power that JYD did.
Tonight is Chris Adams, the Gentleman and the Demon.
Ooh, oh, that'll be a good one. Very juicy story for the Gentleman.
And then next week is Sensational Sherry.
Oh, that'll be a fun one.
And I guess I was wrong. Chris Colt was last week, and the week before was Harley Race.
Ah, I got
But you. I watched both
of
them.
Got them mixed up. Yeah. All right. Well, we got one more card here, Menders, and that's the world class list here. I can do that, too.
Let's go.
All right. All right. So here's our top 10. Of course, a little under half are Von Erichs. But so number So number one, again, the handsome half-breed, Gino Hernandez is one, Kerry Von Erich two, Chris Adams three, speaking of, Kevin Von Erich is 4, Mike Von Erich 5, Killer Khan, the madman from Mongolia, is number 6. Jake Roberts, your buddy Minderz, is number
That
7.
is my buddy.
Iceman King Parsons is number 8. The Missing Link is number 9. And Kelly Kaniski is number 10. Don't know him. His father was, of course, Big Thunder Gene Kaniski, the former World Heavyweight Champion himself.
Gotcha.
So yeah, that's our list from the PWI in Spring 85. Of course, there were other subcategories, but I'm trying to keep it to where it's not going to take up too much time. But yeah, we have that. We have a watch along coming up next week. And Menders, you got to pick the match this time.
I did pick the match this time.
And do you
And
want
I
to
would.
announce it tonight, or do you want to like save it for a surprise?
Well, it's going to be Hacksaw Jim Duggan versus Stunning Steve Austin. And
Oh.
actually happened 29 years ago on what will be next Tuesday. So.
No Brody. Dwayne, he might have been on the list for Florida, but I'm not sure. I have to go back and check. But right now I'm going to bring to our little chat here our buddy Jabari Sinclair. How are you, sir?
Yo, what's happening, peoples?
We saved
Hey,
the
he's
juicy
here.
stuff. We saved the juicy stuff for you, my friend.
Well, damn right. It's a Tuesday, and we've all been looking forward to picking this apart.
Yes.
Yeah.
More than you know.
And I'm gonna have a beer because I've had a long day.
I think
You
alcohol
do
might be
not.
needed for this episode here.
I cracked open a Monaco for this one.
Apparently, it was time for a social drink because we all took a drink.
Right.
Yeah. Oh.
I thought about bringing my Crystal Head vodka over here because I think there might be a need for some shots at some point. But
Whew. Hey, that Crystal Skull vodka is pretty good.
Yes, it
pretty
is.
smooth.
AJ and I know all about that.
Uh-huh. That and
All right.
that alien vodka that we drank.
Jesus
Have
Christ.
updates. That Area 51 raid a couple years back.
Yeah.
Well, AJ, you got to get into my good stuff on the WrestleMania weekend.
Oh yeah.
I
I was not planning on having that many, but things happen.
Yeah. Well, mi casa su casa, as they say.
Well,
But
I appreciate it. Whew.
No. Stacy says we don't drink it
Has
very much
any
anyway, so.
Has anyone tried the rocks drink? What are you referring to,
Oh,
Dwayne?
Terramana? Yes. I am a
Oh
big fan of
yeah.
Terramana.
I like Terramana.
I
Yeah.
don't
Oh,
talk
one of
about
my
Terramana.
I like the Blanco
One of my right,
myself.
one of my guys. Christmas.
I don't speak of Terramana.
Terramana for my birthday.
Yeah.
That was good.
Yeah.
I planned on saving a little bit of it for, drink the Rocks tequila with the Rocks WrestleMania match, but it did not make it that long.
Yeah, well, as things will right, as plans will be, plans will go awry. So,
Yeah. All right, are we going to get
right.
into this?
Hey, you know what? Why before we do, why don't we pay some bills real quick, and then
Okay.
we'll get into it.
Sounds
All
good.
right. All right, here we go.
Make
Man, I'm good.
So I have a question, Reb. I know you
Shoot.
brought this up to me a couple weeks ago. Do we happen to have a video from our old podcast partner, of what he thought about last week?
Not yet. He had opinions, but it's yeah, he didn't have a video for us this week. I'm talking about getting a Grumpy Gary segment going where he's just going to send me in a video where he's venting about various things.
I thought you were setting up for the didn't happen, it's a work video.
Oh, no, I got that, but no, this... this
never happened, it's a work.
Yeah, that's what I thought it was going to be.
Now, Gary, you sent me a message asking if he would, if I would like for him to start giving us a video of him just complaining about things, and I was like, yeah.
Yeah.
But he hasn't, had a chance.
Yes, we do.
But he didn't have a chance to do it. Actually, he wanted to send a recording, but I asked him if he could do video, so. Because you gotta get the face, you know.
Right.
All right, so.
All right, where are we starting?
I can put it off no longer, but I did have to go. Yep.
Ah.
Get my crystal head.
Hey.
Priorities.
That's why I wanted to pay the bills, so I could do it without being noticed. But
smart.
Yes. All right. So, just a little backstory. 2 weeks ago, CM Punk goes on Errol Hawani's MMA Hour podcast and talks about a lot. I finally listened to the interview, Minderz. So he was there for a couple hours and talked about a little bit of everything going, whether it was WWE, AEW. It was a really good interview.
It was a good interview.
Yeah. And a very brief part of that went into the events of All In at Wembley. Punk gave his side of the story.
Because he couldn't talk about Brawl
Out. No. No, he said he did not have an NDA for All In. But he spoke very eloquently, I thought. Described everything where you could imagine it. Like he didn't try to confuse anybody with half-truths or jumbled details or anything. It was just he just described it how he remembered. And apparently Tony did not like it because, first off, Adam Copeland comes out two weeks ago and gives a very, we'll call it, passionate promo about it stopping with the tribalism and just watch wrestling and just enjoy yourself. Let me cut in real fast
about that Copeland promo that he cut. He cut that, and 3/4 of the damn people didn't know what the hell he was talking about because we didn't know about the Hawani interview with Punk yet. So, yeah, it was heartfelt, it was passionate, but it felt like it came out of nowhere.
Yeah, and it did get at the time, you get the idea that Tony sent Copeland out there to respond to Punk.
Yeah.
But
you do, but here's the thing, though. I mean, there are passionate people that are in the back there. There are talented people in the back there.
Yeah, and none of our issues are with the talent.
No, and that's what I hate is that everybody has been throwing up on Twitter and everything about how, you just hate AEW. We don't hate the talent at AEW.
No, they're loaded
with
talent.
We're annoyed with the booking of AEW.
Yes, the management, the creative, the...
Yeah.
I feel like this is a good time to throw the disclaimer on there. I want AEW to succeed, and I want them to do well. More competition in one market is good for the overall wrestling business. I want them to do well, but then they go and do boneheaded, dumb shit like this, and it's
anybody that actively roots for a wrestling company to fail is not a true wrestling fan. That's just my take.
Exactly.
So anyway, so Copeland cuts his promo 2 weeks ago. Apparently Dax cut a promo after the show went off the air. I haven't had a chance to watch it. And then during Collision, which was going on opposite WrestleMania, Tony has the brilliant idea to announce that they are going to show the surveillance footage from backstage at Wembley on Dynamite. And they didn't even say who it was of. I mean, apparently they can't say Punk's name. But now, I admit, when they first announced this, I thought, it was going to be the Young Bucks doing some bullshit parody, or it was going to be, like, legitimate backstage footage of something else, like the Bucks FTR or something backstage.
And we all said as much on here.
We did.
Mm-hmm. So minutes before it aired, I was like, this is not going to be showing Jack Perry or CM Punk. And
no. Well, I was expecting a complete bait and switch.
Yeah.
But anyway, so we were all very surprised to find out that they actually played the actual footage of what happened. Mm-hmm. And it's the Young Bucks are the ones presenting it, which I guess give them a little credit for trying to weave it into an actual storyline that's going on, I guess, maybe. But it just didn't make sense. They were talking about it like they were involved. They weren't in the video.
Nope.
Exactly. They weren't in the video. Neither was FTR. Had they been better storytellers, then maybe they could have pulled something off. Maybe.
Maybe, yeah. Maybe. I mean.
And don't stretch the maybe, baby.
And so they cut to the footage, and there's no audio whatsoever. Like, that's a muted video.
Well, you'd figure, though, it's closed circuit. So
right.
Usually it's, that doesn't CCTV. Have audio. Yeah.
The Bucks aren't offering anything over the top of it, like describing what's going on.
Like which normal probably people is for would. The best.
Right. The footage is almost blow by blow exactly what Punk said happened.
Almost.
That's the thing to realize. So what Tony was trying to get out of this is still a mystery to me, because if they were trying to make Punk look bad, they just made it look like he's not lying.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Well, it depends on who you ask.
Well, that's true.
Because there's a lot of people out there that are like, well, Punk was lying. He tried to take a swing at Jack.
No, he didn't.
And I'm like,
it's right there on video.
Yeah.
Clearly, he did not try to take a swing at Jack. Right. He got tired of Jack's fucking mouth, mm-hmm. shoved him, mm-hmm. face lock.
Will come to Jesus uh-huh. there, and
he goozled it.
Yeah, then I didn't realize until I saw the video, Joe actually like cradled Perry like a swaddled baby and moved him out of the out of the fracas.
Yeah, like he was a Fabergé egg,
pretty much. And Punk said something to Tony, who was cowering behind the monitors, fearing for his life, apparently.
I was saying, Dwayne put up a comment about, he had one thing to say, Tony said he fears for his life, but he wasn't in the video. Tony was right behind, he was the there, you just couldn't
there.
See him.
Yeah, and you also kind of Dave Meltzer,
see him.
He puts
yeah,
a
you
hand
can see
up.
His hand, yeah.
Yeah.
Then Dave Meltzer saying, oh, they didn't air the part where Tony was afraid for his life. I was like, come on, Dave.
That was sure it right there. Didn't. What are you doing, dude? Why are you lying? There goes right. that word again, lying.
Journalistic integrity out the window for Dave Meltzer.
You know, I think there's been worse locker room fights in some of our indie shows around here than what that was. I'm kind of with Joe on this whole thing that I didn't think it was that big of a deal. That just looked like a skirmish.
It was a skirmish, yeah.
Yeah.
A come to Jesus moment.
There wasn't no fight. Jack Perry ran his mouth to a grown man and got snatched in 2 seconds. That's all that was.
Exactly. Yep.
Yeah.
Nobody got hurt. It's just, you know, I didn't notice Chris Hero there till I think I watched the video. Then I listened to the corny drive through when they were breaking it down, and then I went back and watched the video again because I still have a DVR on my YouTube TV.
So say you found it somewhere.
No, I never erased the DVR, so it's still on last week's episode.
That's about the only place you can still see it.
Oh, I know. Because Don Stevens was on the ball on Wednesday.
Sure was. I got it at work recorded, so got that forever.
Yeah. mm-hmm. Oh, my goodness. But Punk then calls Tony a clown, says the place is a joke. I mean, that's what Punk said happened. Obviously, we can't hear what he says on the video, so we'll...
With as much
clear.
As Punk told the truth about everything else, I'll believe that's what he said.
Yeah, I have no reason to doubt what Punk said there because everything he said in the video happened.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't take Punk for a liar, so.
Well, and they took the interview he did with Ariel. I don't know if you guys see this, but before they started copywriting everything, did you?
They synced it.
And they synced it together. And to paraphrase something I heard on Corny's, it was almost like listening to Dark Side of the Moon and watching The Wizard of Oz, just how well it was synced together.
It was like, perfect.
Verbatim, yeah. What happened.
Yeah.
I saw that too.
Yeah. So, with that said, then, of course, you know, you mentioned it. Tony tried to pull damage control, and they tried to put copyright strikes on all the videos online that are showing the footage. And that's where I want to bring you in here, AJ, because you did your homework on this.
Boom.
Now, we are not legal experts. We're not lawyers. I actually was tempted to see if I could get Stephen P. New to actually call in and talk about this, but I don't think it would have happened. So, AJ, I asked if you could kind of do your research on, and I forget the name of the law. I think it's something in the UK about
footage. General Data Protection Regulation and the Data Protection Act of 2018.
There you go.
Which, once again, we are American. So, from what I'm understanding, our understandings of what these laws are saying could be completely off, just because reading it, all this as an American, there's just the same. We could read the same thing and have it be understood in a completely different way across the pond.
Yeah.
But basically, everyone must follow data protection principles, and it must be used fairly, lawfully, transparency, and only for specified, explicit purposes, and kept no longer than necessary.
Okay, so I'm gonna jump in here. So that means Tony had the footage so they could do their investigation into the matter, and the disciplinary committee could make their decision on who was at fault and all this stuff. So after they were done with that.
That could be what they had the footage for. That could be, or Tony Khan appeared in the footage and he could very well have filled out an SAR or subject access request, which if you're trying to get access to footage you appear on a CCTV thing, you can fill out this form and have this footage for an amount of time determined to be no longer than necessary.
Okay. Even though it was his hand. His hand is visible, so.
Right. Anybody in that footage could have filled one of those out and gotten it. He may have gotten it that way. We do not know that they got it for their internal investigation.
Okay.
Try not to get us sued here.
Right. No, yeah, everything we're saying is all purely speculative. We're not saying anything specifically happened or didn't happen as far as the legal ramifications of this goes.
Mm-hmm. But the part that I found interesting was, I have a screenshot for this. If footage taken from your surveillance system is uploaded to the internet, either intentionally or inadvertently, you could be held as responsible as a consequence, face fines, as well as possible reputational damage. Release footage to the police, not Facebook or YouTube.
Or so, national television.
Exactly. Yeah, no, I wasn't really able to find a specific aired on national television subset of the laws, mostly because I'm assuming nobody thought somebody was going to do that. but I did find social media, and that could explain that footage being taken down everywhere. But that would get not only Tony Khan, but Wembley Stadium as well in some hot water legally, because that is Wembley Stadium's footage.
Yeah. So it doesn't say a specific amount of time that the footage can be kept. It just says as long as needed.
Yep. For as long as necessary, for legal reasons, like if a crime was committed and somebody was going to court about it, they would have access to that for the duration of the court proceedings, and then the footage would be destroyed.
Okay. Looks like we lost Minderz for a second. Let's get her back in.
Yeah.
Did you do that just so you wouldn't have Tony on your corner?
No. Our power went out. Oh, we got storms going on down here. Yeah, we got storms going on down here.
Storms are coming this way, too, so they hit y'all first. Okay.
They're hitting us first.
Jade Cargill. All
no.
Right, so anyway.
No.
All right, AJ, let's keep diving into this here. So what else you got?
Do you want to know what the consequences could be legally if anybody decided to press charges or go to court?
I would love to know this, because I think Stephen P. New knows this, because I think he warned AEW about some of this stuff.
Fines of up to, do you want to make this a game? Do you want to guess how high of the fine is? Which
I like it.
I cross-checked between a few different websites, and they all said something similar to this effect of these dollar amounts. So who wants to take a guess as to what the fines can go up to for that?
All right, for violating Price is Right style. Highest without going over.
I'm gonna say $15K.
$15K?
Yeah.
Minderz? Red.
You know what? I'm gonna go extreme. I think it's $150K.
Ooh. See, I was gonna say 100, so I'm saying 100,000.
You guys lowballed the hell out of it.
Don't say it yet. Really? Hang on.
All right. What is
AEW and Wembley Stadium could be fined up to $17.5 million or 4% of their annual global turnover, whichever is greater.
Buddy.
Yeah, that is how a business, not an individual, a business can get fined for violating the GDPR and Data Protection Act.
Wow. You said 17. How much?
Woo!
$17.5 million or 4% of annual global turnover, whichever is greater.
Wow. Yeah.
This could
There's all your Wembley earnings.
Wembley could very well have to pay that too.
Oh wow.
Here's my question.
This could be the end of the relationship with AEW and Wembley.
Mm. Could Wembley ostensibly sue Tony for their part of the fine? Because Tony showed it?
They probably could. But I do know that the posting those things to that footage to social media,
such hayseeds to get us into the thousands. What are we thinking?
If footage from your surveillance system is uploaded to the internet either intentionally or inadvertently, you could be held responsible. So yeah, Wembley Stadium could very well be on the hook as well.
And technically, I saw it on YouTube TV, so that's the internet.
Yeah.
And that is in addition to criminal charges and civil suits.
Wow.
And I started with UK.gov as a starting point for there, and then I also found several other websites of like. One was a security company that installs CCTVs. One was a legal firm, and I checked various other websites and they all said something similar to that effect. They were pretty consistent throughout on what laws they have to follow is. So I'm gonna say that this information is probably good. But once again, we are American and these are British laws, so we could have a completely wrong understanding of this.
And it's an American company that did it, so that might have an effect on it too.
Maybe.
Look, I just want to clarify this. It's 17.5 million American dollars, not euros or pounds or whatever.
Pounds, my bad.
Pounds,
my bad.
Okay, then I'm.
That's
then
even more.
Now I'm going to go to.
Hold on, I'll do it, Rip. I know what you're doing. I know what you're doing.
Okay. Oof. Well, even so, that's a lot of key, sure.
Yeah. If any charges are pressed or anybody decides that they want to sue, I don't know. Shad Khan might be like, what the hell are you doing over here, Tony?
Right. Oh my gosh.
He's right. He's stepped in it and wallowed all around in it.
And tracked it in the house.
That's what has happened.
Buddy.
I know that sound. Minderz, what do you got?
It's $21.7 million. No, wait. Yeah, $7 million. $21.7 million.
Damn. Man.
That's.
Chad, what do you think?
just as a point, Vince McMahon, I think, got, what, 9 million in stocks?
Right.
Recently, when he sold more of his share. So he got 9 million. We thought that was a lot of money. This is looking at 20 plus million dollars here.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
At what point does Shaw just step in? Hey, Tony, what the fuck are you doing?
Right.
Another point I would like to make about what is defined as personal data under these UK laws. Personal data does not just mean, your name and your address and stuff like that. It can also mean anything that any video or camera footage that can be used to identify somebody.
So somebody's likeness.
Yeah, so we could, from looking at that video, it's like, yeah, that's CM Punk. Yeah, that's Jack Perry. Yeah, that's Samoa Joe. So you could easily argue that this qualifies.
Oh,
you got Chris Tony. Hero. You've got,
I think, Paul Turner. I think Aubrey was in there.
Aubrey was in there.
Anybody that was getting ready to have a match is pretty much there. Malachi Black was standing there.
Yeah.
Jerry Lynn was there.
Jerry Lynn.
Two words.
And then some other
not Punk, but literally anybody who appears could press charges.
Right.
Wow.
I don't really care about him, but Jack Perry could sue over this.
Yeah, he technically could.
They made Jack look bad in this video.
Could you imagine if all those people sued?
Let's do a class action suit against Tony Khan.
Do a class action suit against it? God, they weren't kidding when they said that CM Punk could really do the funniest thing ever.
Yeah, because the reason I started looking at that was that exact tweet was about how Punk could do the funniest thing ever. And I'm like, huh, so can he sue or something? And then I saw a British wrestling fan going off about it on Reddit, like, yeah, this is definitely not okay. And that's what prompted doing all this digging into it.
Oh.
Stacey, it's considered personal information because it was closed circuit. It was CCTV. Yep. So that's why it's considered personal. It doesn't matter if they're on TV already.
Uh-huh.
I think.
And
am I understanding that right?
Yeah, it would essentially be if the same as if it happened in the back room of a Walmart as well. Because it was not a public place. It was the back area.
It's just basically surveillance footage. It's not like...
Yeah, surveillance footage. And actually...
For the purposes of being on broadcast.
Mm-hmm. And that surveillance footage is solely for the purpose of catching the commission of a crime to go to the police with. They're not even legally allowed to keep tabs on their employees. Oh, you're not doing this. Oh, this need to be filled however minutes ago. They're not even allowed to say that to their employees using that footage. It is purely and strictly for the purpose of having evidence if there is a commission of a crime to take to court and go to the police.
Can Tony's booking be considered a crime?
I'm sure in some countries it is.
Bari, what were you saying? Not happening.
I don't even remember.
I wasn't as good as... Okay. I know you're trying to say something, so...
I was, but I lost it.
I'm sorry, buddy. It's okay. This is a lot to digest here.
Unless Tony Khan went before a judge and got permission from a judge and police to use and air that footage, he could be in some hot water.
A British judge, no less.
Yeah, he'd had to fly out to the UK, go to a British judge, get permission from the judge and the police to use that footage.
Could he have asked British to do it for him?
Under British Commonwealth. So guess what? Anything can be deemed illegal in the Commonwealth. So
yeah,
this
is Osprey do it.
Really
he definitely to hire Regal. I was like, hey Regal, go do this for me. I know you don't work for me anymore.
Yeah, I had no idea the extent of how bad that might be legally, hot water, but he better be praying every night that CM Punk doesn't say, yeah, I want to press charges. for distributing my personal data.
Do you think exactly. Stephen Pinu was chomping at the bit right now?
Probably.
Oh, I bet he is.
Call him Punk. Please let me do this. Please. Let me do this. Please.
Not only is he chomping at the bit, but he's salivating at this point. Salivating.
God, he is Googling what he has to do to get licensed to practice law in the UK to open up a firm there as we speak.
Oh, good.
Hold on. Lord. I'm just curious. Hold on.
What are you looking at?
Go what it normally is of to. I'm just trying to figure out if you took 10% of that, that'd be what? $2 million?
Seven.
That'd be a good payday for him.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You don't think he'd do that pro bono?
Payday for him.
Well, once again, he is a lawyer in the United States. It would need to be a British lawyer doing it. Somebody right. who's a lawyer it's in the UK. License. I don't think Stephen P. New could legally take it. But I'm just a simple small town bird lawyer. I don't.
True. I mean,
do we have any other ones we can guess and find out how much it is?
I can probably look some up.
No, that's fine. Boy. Yeah, that's
basically
definitely
Tony's
something
gonna
Tony
get
has
fined.
Stepped in.
He's going to get fined every penny he's paying Sasha Banks, pretty much, at this point.
Mm-hmm. Should anybody decide to press charges, he very well could.
Well, probably Sasha, Ospreay, and Okada. So
probably. Plus all of Ospreay's plane tickets.
Exactly. If he didn't have Ospreay already looking into this for him. Because, you know, he's there every week.
I fought 8 hours every week, bruv.
Yeah,
sorry.
Also, my brother in court who gets put in contempt.
Yeah. Okay, you know what my gripe about that promo is? About the, I'm doing flights back and forth every week, bruv. Like, nobody told him he couldn't get a hotel in the next town.
Right.
Nobody told him he couldn't do that.
Well, that was
That seemed more like bragging than defending himself when he said that.
Yeah, that's
What I thought, but.
That sounds like a him thing that he's doing. He could very well stay for a few weeks and get a hotel in the next town or something. He doesn't have, I get wanting to see your family, of course, but he doesn't have to do those flights every week.
No. So this
get an Airbnb, bring him over here.
There you go. So this whole thing is just a part of a really abysmal Dynamite last Wednesday.
It was bad.
Everything.
Which I think the fact that we're even questioning the legality of it sounds like a pretty good reason to not do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm willing to bet that Tony didn't even consider it. He just thought, I'm just going to play this because I have it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because
Tony's an idiot. to Tony.
Whew.
To Tony.
Yeah. I'll finish my game.
If you get it, you get it. But
right.
So Bari, you know the hashtag that was flying all over the place during that Dynamite last week was hashtag WCW2000, and there was specifically talking about the footage. A picture came across that I wanted to look at. Minderz, what's up?
Please show it. I know what you're talking about. But go ahead.
What?
Not please quite, show. But just as. Just as cringeworthy.
But look at this picture here. Tell me what you see.
Now, poor Tony.
In my head, I see Excalibur trying to put this over. Oh, this is great footage. This is gonna make us so many ratings. And Taz is like, I'm not touching this. And then Tony's like,
Taz doesn't care.
Already.
Let me tell you something.
Taz don't care.
Taz does not. Care as long as his fucking check clears, he doesn't give a fuck what they do.
As long as they don't fuck with this kid.
Don't hurt my baby and make sure my check cashes.
Tell me to see a flashbacks of the finger poke of doom, Bash at the Beach 2000, Butts in Seats, all that stuff that went on.
I would say it's more butts in seats, I think.
It's a lot of butts in seats, but a lot of Bash 2000 also. But yeah, he was. Yeah, he's. I feel like he's about to piss himself.
Yeah, he's so.
He was not happy.
If Tony Schiavone knew about this beforehand, you know he tried to talk Tony Khan out of it. Because if anybody knows, he does.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And, definitely.
Yeah. And it also should be pointed out, the reports going around that the Bucks did not want to do it. It was Tony's idea, but the Bucks did it because, you know, it's them on TV. And Ospreay's promo was not Ospreay's idea. They didn't say who came up with it, but okay. I got a feeling.
Was it really not their idea? Not their idea. Now there's backlash.
That's what I read online.
Now it's
up in the air.
So are they saying, oh, it wasn't our idea?
Are they backpedal? They could backpedal and fall right into a pile of fecal matter.
But, yeah, if these had gotten over and people loved them, would they be saying, oh, yeah, that was the best thing I ever did? All my idea.
They probably would. But talking about Ospreay's promo, though, I mean, it's just so unoriginal, the crack on Hunter. I mean, it's the same shit that all the smart marks have been saying for 20 years about Triple H, that he only got his job because he was banging the boss's daughter. I mean, come on. It sounds like sour grapes to me, because Tony's getting his ass kicked by Triple H right now. Creatively.
Yeah, there's no competition. And then who's to say that whatever Triple H said in that interview was directed at Will Ospreay?
He didn't name anybody. Right, you've been talking about Okada for all I know.
He named nobody. And here you go, putting your fucking foot in your mouth.
Tony.
Because you think you somebody. Yeah, because you think you somebody.
Or Ospreay.
And you let them do that to you. So, yeah, let's see how this all plays out.
They were talking about this on Busted Open, and at the end of yesterday's show, the Monday show, they were talking about Ospreay's promo, and the last thing Bully Ray said before they went off the air is, Triple H will not forget this. Very poignant.
Nope.
Because if Tony shits the bed and Ospreay needs a job, what's the first place he's going to go to? He's going to go to WWE.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to meet with Triple H.
Ospreay may as well go back to New Japan.
He'd probably make a good living back at New Japan, but it'd be a lateral step, not a step backwards necessarily. From AEW.
I would just like to say that Triple H was.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, AJ.
I would just like to say about the banging the boss's daughter comments. Triple H was already a main eventer and former world champion before him and Stephanie got married.
And
just saying.
And I'm gonna make a hot take here. And I think the world of Ospreay's work, I've been on the record about that, how good I think he is. Will Ospreay now could not lace 2,000 Triple H's boots in the ring.
No.
No.
Not even on Triple H's bad day.
No.
Not psychologically, not in-ring, not promos, nothing. I mean, that's just
37 false finishes. 37 false finishes, yeah. 37 false finishes, yeah.
Yep, kicking out of all the protected moves. And...
Yeah, that makes me sick, and we ought to have a discussion about that one day, but not now.
That's a $10 fine.
Yeah.
Yeah. False finishes? Heck no, that's $20. That's $20.
Oh, my goodness.
Are we going to talk about Jack Perry at the New Japan show?
I think it would be germane to do that. He shows up in Chicago, by the way, so he's going right into Punk's neighborhood for this New Japan show. I forget who he wrestled.
It was Shota Umino.
Okay, no, so Shooter.
Oh, but yeah, that's right.
Number who? One, Shota Umino. He's Moxley's young boy in Japan.
Red Shoes' kid.
Ah, okay. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
No. Red Shoes' kid is Narita, isn't it?
I thought Umino was Red Shoes' kid. Hold on, I'm going to Google it.
Look it up. But anyway,
I don't know who Umino is.
So, Umino's one of the like top young lions they got. He's supposedly in the next elite class after the Okada Naito group.
Okay.
Yes, he is Red Shoes' kid.
Oh, it is him. Okay, I thought it was Rinder.
I'll watch
him. He's really good, by the way. I've seen him plenty. I've been watching him since he was a young boy. So
duly noted. I'm writing it down now. Mitsubishi.
Okay. No, it's not Mitsubishi. Shame on you. So Perry comes out for his match. He's draped in the Chicago flag when he comes out, so that's going to get him heat automatically.
He's disrespectful. That's Chicago's flag.
I mean, Punk's flag, Chicago's flag, isn't it?
Punk's flag. It's basically the Chicago flag with like different doodads on it. But anyway, of course, the crowd starts chanting CM Punk right off the bat.
And the back of his jacket said Cry Me a River. And he had to be escorted to the ring by security because he is so dangerous.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. You know what? Right then and there, it should have been 6-7 of them four corner hustlers from Chicago hit the fucking ring and beat the dog shit out of him because of the fucking disrespect. I'm sorry. I don't like Jack Perry. Nothing about him is credible.
He's in the Bullet Club in New Japan.
Yeah, well,
he's in the House of Torture. What?
Yeah, and so was everybody else.
He's got a point. Bullet Club's kind of like the NWO of New Japan. Yeah,
kind of. Sort of.
There's like four different subsets of Bullet Club right now in wrestling.
Guess what? Whenever they let fucking Billy Gunn's babies join the Bullet Club of any iteration, it was a done fucking deal then.
That's Tony Club. That's not. That's barely Bullet Club. Let's be honest.
Bullet
Club. Look black and white. Don't let your hate for taters and mustard find you.
Anyway, so. Get well, Juice indeed. I miss Juice. But Jack lost his match on Friday, Bari. Shooter beat him.
Yeah, he did. Yeah.
Yeah, because he got too busy playing to the crowd, doing the go to sleep thing and doing the CM Punk talks and all of that and got caught.
Well, Shooter should have slapped them stupid sideburns off him, too.
Oof, oh, my goodness. So, yeah, Perry, of course. Then also, we should mention Matt Jackson wearing the scapegoat T-shirt on Dynamite. So, is it a safe bet that Perry's going to come back and join the Elite at this point?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And nobody's going to give a shit.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody's going to care.
They've ruined Okada already.
Every time he comes out, I pray that they chant CM Punk's name to the high fucking heaven.
They're going to. At least for a while.
I would just like to say I loved the promo after they aired the footage where Cash Wheeler called the Young Bucks Rod and Todd Flanders.
I pop for it.
Me too.
We're God Squad.
Another sticking point. You mentioned FTR. They came out for a promo that's supposed to be impromptu and not on the format. Why did they have music?
Right.
They should have just marched down the ramp with no music, pissed off, and just grab a microphone, not coming out to their entrance.
No, remember
like Jeff Hardy coming out to save Matt.
Explained why people have music when they're not scheduled on an episode of Raw from several years ago. Seth Rollins was marching to the ring, and Mick Foley was next to – he walked right past Mick Foley. Mick Foley pulled out a walkie-talkie and said, cue Seth Rollins' music.
Huh.
Why people have music when they're unscheduled to be out there, that did get explained a long time ago.
Okay.
Still dumb.
Yeah.
All right, so
at least somebody had an explanation.
Yeah, I mean that's true.
I don't like it, but yeah, sure.
No, going back to Dynamite last week, and we saw the ratings. I think they averaged what 820 something for that episode, Minderz.
Hold on, 'cause I heard it earlier. It was like 880. $50,000 for that segment.
Yeah. And then it just dropped off again.
No big surprise. Then it just dropped. Like, it dropped down. I think on average it was like $829.
I think it was like $790-something.
Was it lower?
Maybe 760 for that main event segment with Dustin.
Yeah, it was real bad. It was real bad.
Yeah, I did not make it past the Ospreay promo personally.
Neither did Renee. Renee wanted to get the fuck out of there when he was talking. Yeah, she's like, see it in her face.
This is bad. I may need her again one day for a job.
Right?
Yeah.
And Renee, like, you know,
I hope they don't forget that I was here for this when I put in an application there here in a couple of years.
Right.
Yeah.
So
exactly. AJ.
Either she and Tony were really good at selling all of a sudden, or they are legitimately really uncomfortable during that show last week. And I'm more inclined. I don't think either one can sell that well. So.
No, I don't either. So I'm going to say that they're both really uncomfortable with it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Ugh.
Good Lord.
I know I would have been.
Yeah, well, Mr. Springtime really.
Because it was cringe. It was cringy. Why would you, at this time right now, why would you show that? It's one thing to show it the week after it happened or whatever. But why would you show it now? It's not been a year after that shit happened. Like,
and now I remember when all this first happened, Bari, we were saying show the footage. We wanted to see it.
Yeah.
Hashtag show the
footage was trending.
Right. We wanted to know what happened, and then
show the tape.
And obviously Tony didn't show it for a long time because he knew it was going to make him look bad. So I don't know what switch flipped in his friggin' empty head that made him decide that it was a good time to do it now, right after WrestleMania, when WWE made almost enough money to pay his fine, basically.
Yeah.
And
well, you know what it was that set him off was Punk.
It was Punk. Yeah.
It was Punk. He's too busy worrying about what Punk's doing. That's the problem I see with AEW right now. Yeah. They're too worried. They're too worried about what AEW's doing or what WWE's doing. They're too worried about it.
And WWE has said nothing about this situation, AEW in general, or Tony Khan specifically at all.
No.
All this happened on a podcast from Punk, and If Tony was smart, he would go on Ariel Helwani's podcast and respond, but Ariel won't put him on his podcast because last time he was a freaking shit show.
He wouldn't answer anything. No. Punk. He was a punk, and not in a good way.
No.
and you know, it is possible that CM Punk just laughs at this, says, ha-ha, I told you, and then never presses charges or worries about any of this ever again. You know, I was right. I'm gonna let their reputation tank.
But can he keep this in his back pockets where if they push him, he can say, "Oh, by the way, I'm gonna sue you for this."
There's probably a statute on it.
Punk's made
a lot of money in his career, and he's saved wisely, from what I understand, from what I hear about him. So he doesn't need the money.
Exactly.
I think he doesn't need the money. Right. Yeah, I think I think he'd just as soon just sit back and watch their reputation go down the shitter.
I don't think any of these, like, if what I looked up legally is, you know, if he does have these options to, you know, go after them legally, I still don't think he will. I think he'll be content to be like, ha, now everybody saw I was right. That's all I needed. Plus, have fun looking like an idiot.
Plus, he's also said he's got a lot of friends that work for the company, so I'm sure he doesn't want to bankrupt AEW and put all his friends out of a job.
Yeah, that too.
Right.
I'm sure that's a big part of it.
He doesn't want any of them to get any pushback either.
Mm-hmm.
Did you say Joaquin Phoenix?
I meant Joaquin.
He's on NXT right now.
Oh.
Joaquin Wild, not Joaquin.
Okay. BJZ.
Zima Ion.
Yeah.
And Ridge Holland.
So Joaquin's gonna die, basically.
Basically.
Oh my goodness. So
he's taking a few really bad bumps.
Sorry.
Yeah,
sorry about that.
No, you're good. So I'm not gonna spend too much more time on this because it's just a fucking fiasco.
This is a disservice to AEW. This is what's not going to help you. any way this hurt you, and let's again, let's just see what happens down the line.
Well, we saw footage of Collision, and there was nobody in that fucking building for that show, which made us, we were talking about this, and we wondered, is it because nobody bought tickets for the show, or worse, is it people bought tickets, but then they watched Dynamite and then said, fuck it, I'm not going to this.
Exactly. And no, did you guys see that? Go ahead.
No, go ahead, Bari.
No, I was going to say, did you guys see where Billy Starks posted the Dynamite card tomorrow and was like, who's going to be in Louisville for Dynamite? And like three people didn't respond it. Yeah.
Oh, one more thing.
People responded.
One more thing while we were on this topic. I did go ahead and look up. I don't know why I didn't look it up during my research. But the current period for making a claim for data breach compensation is 6 years from the date of the breach, or 1 year where it involves a breach of human rights. So he has anywhere from 1 to 6 years to decide if he wants to press charges.
So we'll have to wait and see what happens there.
So get all your buddies out of there so they don't lose their jobs and then bankrupt them.
No. We don't want to bankrupt AEW.
I think they're going to bankrupt themselves regardless.
Yeah, Tony might be an idiot and do it himself, but we don't want that to happen because we want these guys to have places to work. And Tony just needs to find somebody to just run the train, you know? Tony can be the money guy.
Like we've always said, he has people there that would.
Yeah,
there's Jerry Lynn. There's Chris Hero. There's
the worst thing Tony Khan ever did for that company is let Cody Rhodes go. And yeah. I'm not saying that because he's the world champion WWE, because Cody could be that sounding board and tell Tony when something was a bad idea.
And he was the only EVP that acted like an EVP.
Exactly. He was helping build, and he wore the suit.
All that. But Cody seen the writing on the wall and got out.
Yeah, pretty much.
I want to know what pushed Cody to the edge, and I don't think we're going to find out till that NDA runs out of whatever they signed when they left.
Everything Cody has said in interviews has always been very complimentary of Tony and of AEW. So it could just be him taking the high road. I don't know. I mean, Cody's a pretty private guy from the sounds of it. So
Brandy didn't seem to be too upset about trying to say something.
No, Brandy's a different animal altogether.
Brandy wants to talk. She wants to talk.
It's open mic night, she says.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Right.
Yeah. I loved when Cody said that on SmackDown, too, about The Rock.
That was good.
That popped.
So, just my last little 2 cents here is, and I'm not going to say anything more about the footage or Ospreay's promo. This is about Tony here. And Tony has become very good at ruining things. He's ruined Dynamite. He's ruined Collision, obviously. Because Collision was our favorite show on AEW for the first, 3 weeks? Before he
and it was thriving, right, Yeah, it was going to be a thing, and it was going to thrive.
Right.
I really enjoyed those 6 weeks of Collision.
So did I.
When Punk had control, starting in June, to Wembley, Collision was great.
Yeah.
It was great.
Now it just became Saturday Dynamite, and it's shit.
And it's even worse.
Rampage has always been awful. And again, this is all purely based on booking. This is not a reflection on the talent.
Not at all.
No.
It's time for the main event.
Yeah, that's all they have Mark Henry doing. He's like the chief on Carmen Sandiego. But
all right, Gumshoes.
It's just right.
See what I did there.
I see what you did there. But it's so frustrating, you know, because I mean, Tony has I can't speak for everybody. He's got my dream job, you know, to have a wrestling promotion to be involved in all this stuff. He's just pissing it away. It's ridiculous. It's just infuriating to me because it's not hard. I mean, I'm not going to say it's easy because I've never done it, but if you get the right people around you that know what they're doing, it's fine. It's not.
And take their advice.
Exactly.
Take this guy has, I'm as qualified as Tony Khan is to run a wrestling company. And I'm not saying that because of ego. Tony Khan is me with $1 billion in his pocket. That's basically what it comes down to. But the difference is I listen to people. You guys know I have ideas. We all have booking ideas, and we talk about them all the time. But we also know that there are people that know more than we do.
Yeah.
You don't think I'd make Jim Ross my booker if I had AEW? Oh, yeah. I'd hire Bully Ray. Right. If not JR, I'd hire Bubba Ray Dudley. You got Jeff Jarrett right there. You got Jake Roberts back there.
You got Arn Anderson?
Well, yeah, you got Argo.
And Tully.
Yeah. And it's just he could have done so much better. It's ridiculous. I hope he turns around, but I'm afraid it's too late.
Yeah, I'd like to think that if any of us had that kind of money and control over a wrestling promotion and had Arn Anderson or Jake the Snake Roberts, Tully Blanchard, Jim Ross, what have you there, I'd like to think that any of us would have the good sense to be like, hey, JR, I want to run this match going into the pay-per-view. Is this stupid or is this a good idea?
JR would hate me because I would just bug the hell out of him, ask him questions and wanting to hear stories and asking advice and all that. He'd probably just finally tell me to fuck off. But
I'd figure out a way to get corny. I would fix
leave way me the fuck to get
corny. Yeah, you'd have to do a pretty heavy thinning of the roster if you're going to get corny. But
And you'd also have to make it a remote-only thing for him because he ain't going there.
No.
I'd do it. I'd do it though to run just
Corny's
to run
Angels.
Ideas
he could be the voice box on the conference table.
Exactly.
If we had our own promotion and we came to Corny, he would give us advice. He would give us advice.
Oh yeah, he gave Tony advice. He said it before AEW started. He gave Tony advice, and he clearly didn't listen.
Mm-hmm.
And now. The Bucks and Omega and all those guys are so anti-corny that it's just become a Cornette has become a dirty word in AEW.
Exactly.
That's because he called them out.
Mm-hmm. With reason and with logic behind it. He doesn't just He doesn't just call these guys out for no reason. He'll say what sucks, but then he'll talk about how you can fix things. Bully Ray's the same way on Busted Open. Everybody says Bully's an AEW hater. He's never put down AEW. He knows where the screws can be tightened in a lot of cases.
Exactly.
And there's a difference
this
between
is bad and this
and
is
just
bad.
Hate
bad.
Yeah. What was that, AJ?
There's a difference between hating on something just to be a hater and hating on something when you have knowledge to back it up and saying, hey, here's what sucks. Here's how I would have done this differently. And this is how it would have looked better and gone better. Like, I don't know. There's a difference between that and just hating just to be a hater.
Right. I'm glad you mentioned that. I'm going to look so I can find it here. Because somebody posted. Oh, here it is. All right. So there's this guy. I'm not going to mention his name. He's on Twitter, but he's apparently a contributor on some dirt sheet website. And this is what he put on Twitter here. And if you guys follow the Cult of Cornette Facebook page, you've probably seen this. He said, I think I've come to terms on the fact that I'm a full-on WWE hater. There was a point where I thought I would be happy if the product was better. But when they win, they make sure everyone else loses. So I don't want that company to do well. I don't want them to succeed or be booked well. I want them to embarrass themselves constantly so that I can point and laugh at them. That's what would make me the happiest. And this is apparently some sort of a journalist.
That doesn't make any sense to me.
No, I saw that.
Okay, yeah, but yeah, just that kind of logic, and calling it logic is really insulting to logic, but it just makes no sense to me to have that kind of an attitude.
Exactly.
Especially when, I'm enjoying this new era that we've got going on with WWE.
Oh, me too. I'm loving it.
And I wish they would do a hard restart with AEW and just scrap everything and start over.
To do the new blood thing where they just strip all the titles and just do a hard reset on the pay-per-view.
Give me all the belts.
Even Sid has to give up his belt.
Yeah. It's a matter you can't find your scissors.
Oh Eric.
Aww.
Oh my goodness. All right. Have we exhausted this all in AEW talk at this point?
Yeah, I know.
There's a couple other things I want to get into. So let's talk about something that we're happy about. And speaking of happy, there's Turbo.
Yeah. Look at Tears.
Did I tell the fat guy with the beard to calm down?
Well, I can't.
All right. So anyway, let's talk about some happy things. And number one is, and it's, I got Rhea Ripley on the list, but that's not what I'm happy about. Let's talk about
SmackDown.
No, that sucks. We talked about Rhea, but talking about SmackDown, we got Tama Tonga debuting, joining the Bloodline on Friday. I had to go back and watch this.
That's how you
later
debut
on.
Somebody.
It was so good. And that the announcers did a great job of it. They put him over for what he did in Japan. They didn't have to change his name, which I was happy about. He's still Tama Tonga.
They explained who he was. Where, you know, they didn't just show up and, like, Ospreay showed up and they're like, oh, this is Ospreay from New Japan. It was like, no, this is Haku's son. This is...
That's Tama Tonga. That's Haku's oldest boy. That's his oldest boy.
Yeah.
And they put over his work in Japan also, but they made sure that we were aware of that this guy had a reason to be there.
Right.
And
it's the new like Samoan SWAT team.
That's how you put somebody over. That's how you
technically
put
it's the
over.
New Islanders. It's Haku's son and it's Tama's son. So it's the Islanders second generation.
Yeah.
I would love to see them bring in Tongaloa. From what I've heard, that he's not on the radar right now. He might still have more time on his contract, but
well, Tongaloa's WWE before. Maybe somebody backstage, maybe he rubbed somebody backstage the wrong way, and they don't find him again.
He was a Tongan that they presented as a Mexican.
Yep.
Camacho.
Well, yeah, Camacho.
Camacho.
Unico, yeah, him and Unico.
And yeah, but I would love to see Tongaloa. Yeah, that bicycle gimmick was ridiculous.
I did like that bike.
It was a sharp bike, but it was like the Mexicools coming to the ring on lawnmowers. It's kind of on the nose there.
Yeah.
But I would love to see because the Usos have to be getting back together at this point after Jimmy got his ass kicked. So I'm hoping that leads to I'd love to see it be the Usos against the Gorillas of Destiny, but it's probably going to be the Usos against and Solo.
You heard what. Right, you heard what Jay said. He was like, man, I told Jimmy to come with me.
Yep.
To Raw.
I would pop so hard if when we get a segment where Roman is confronting Solo about why did you do this? And Solo just said, I did it for The Rock. I'd pop
he
for
might.
It.
I mean, he might, because I think that's what it is. You know, they said they heard it from the head of the table. I think Roman lost that spot. If you really think about it,
Thomas said by orders of the tribal chief, and it sounds like Solo has assumed the tribal chiefdom, if that's the right word. But just I got it in my head already.
Has,
where,
but okay,
Rock's the high chief. He's not a tribal chief.
But, and never forget, Jacob Fatu is also saying that he has been by WWE as well.
That's what I'm saying. If Jacob comes in and joins the Bloodline. Imagine the pop. Say we get Solo and Tama against the Usos at SummerSlam, we'll say. And this is just a for instance.
Okay.
At the end of the match, all three of those guys, with them and Jacob, are beating down the Usos. Imagine that. I hope they're outdoors because their roof will blow off if Roman's music hits and he comes down and bails out the Usos.
Right.
Because you know that's what's happening.
And he
they got to build the war games. Face.
Mm-hmm. Yep. It's going to be Bloodline Hollywood and Bloodline Wolfpack in War Games.
Right. So it's the assumption is going to be Rock, Solo, Tama, Jacob on Rock side. My tongue tied. Roman and the Usos, but who would their partner be? Would it be Sammy?
That's what I was thinking. Sami Zayn. He He grew up on the island with them. He's a member of the family.
True. it's going to take a lot of storytelling to get back on the same page with Roman, though.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, they could always bring up Zilla, too, though. Zilla Fatu, if he's ready.
True. They could sign him.
He's still green as grass, though.
Umaga's baby boy.
Wouldn't it be ironic if it was Seth?
Yes.
Yeah, Umaga, the irony.
AJ.
Umaga.
Umaga. I forgot about Umaga.
Oh, Umaga.
Yes. So, I'm very curious to see what happens going forward with this Bloodline stuff. Sounds like it's going to be Cody and AJ probably at the Backlash.
Oh, and right, you know, there,
Bari. What are you laughing about?
Sound like Dr. Hibbert?
I'm sorry.
but I agree with you that it's going to be AJ. I think he's going to get his win back over LA Knight at WrestleMania.
I think that's a better matchup. I think that's a better matchup too, Cody and AJ.
Yeah, I agree. Plus, you got a face and a heel there. Why do you want to your top white meat baby face and you want to put him against the cool baby face and split the crowd? No, you want him to a heel going after him.
Yeah. Bari, do you need
I
want to
know what he's laughing about.
What happened on NXT?
Huh? Oh, I'm just having a
thought.
Oh,
no. It would have been the NXT.
Okay, on that square under me?
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, are you okay, Bari?
I'm good. I'm good.
I'll say.
Did you have some recreational goodies before you went on the microphone there, Bari?
You bet your ass I did.
Before and during from the side of it. Like the people who wrote that home book.
All right. So what did The Rock hand Cody? Am I completely in the dark about this?
Yeah, what did he hand?
So here's what I think.
He handed Cody a or Sizzler.
A who?
A what?
Sizzler. He handed him a 2-for-1 card for Sizzler.
Oh, jeez.
I don't think that was it, but okay.
Here's what I've heard. So apparently Cody gave all three guys he was in the main event with at Mania a watch. I think it might have been a Rolex, I don't know. But they all got matching watches. Mm-hmm. And the theory going around is that it was either Rock's watch that Cody gave him or Roman's.
Oh.
Maybe it smashed up or something.
Ah. Okay.
Oh.
I totally missed that
Scott
part,
says,
but all right.
Scott says Cody actually said that. I hadn't heard that. Okay.
I hadn't either.
Well, okay, Mr.
Cody. Cody had a good watch week last week. He got some fancy watch there. He got his dad's Rolex back.
Yep. Yeah.
I forget what model Rolex it was, but it was one that Dusty pawned to send him to acting school.
Yep.
And, yeah. So, I think we've exhausted everything. I'm going to ask this. Well, before we go, talking about Rhea Ripley, apparently they're crowning a new champion next week on Raw. If you pick, who do you think needs to be the new women's champion?
It's got to be Liv Morgan, don't you think?
That's what I think. I think it's got to be. She's got to win the belt, and she's got to go try and woo Dom.
Mm-hmm. She's got to hold that belt until Rhea is healthy. And then when Rhea comes in and just hits her with a riptide, and I know you guys have seen when she hits a riptide on someone smaller than her, and she just pops them up into the air and puts them down.
Oh, yeah.
So when Rhea comes back, hits one of those and then points at the belt, the roof is going to blow off the place or wherever they are at.
I'm calling it now. Rhea wins the Royal Rumble next year. I think that's when she comes back. I think she wins the Rumble. Then she beats Liv at Mania.
Ooh, is she going to be out that long?
If it's the same shoulder injury, she'll be back between November and December. So I can see them just pushing it back to January.
Ooh.
They haven't said specifically what the injury is, though. But Liv said that when she heard her shoulder,
Just please not. Please, 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 please. Not Nia.
She was going to be my second pick if it's actually.
They're going to belt Nia next week. What are y'all talking about? Right. All this Liv Morgan, dirty Jersey girl nonsense is just nonsense. They're going to put the belt on Nia. There. And I said it.
My second pick if Liv doesn't win it.
I was hoping that they were going to push it back a little bit and not do it right away next week. Maybe push it to the pay-per-view.
Yeah, why not do it at Backlash and France?
I know, right? But I'll tell you who in this. But maybe push it back to after the draft, get some new faces into the women's division, and then go about it. And then I was thinking, if it's not Liv, and I'm thinking it's probably going to be Liv, but if it wasn't her, I would love to see it be Tiffany Stratton.
That was the other one I was thinking. That was who I was thinking. Was okay. Tiffany.
I would like that. It's Tiffy time. Yeah. Trained by Mr. Kennedy.
I mean, you've got, because we're going to have what? Bayley versus Naomi. Which, whatever.
Which, that's next week on SmackDown.
But, yeah. Okay.
I can see it being Tiffany and Bayley going forward if she stays on SmackDown.
I hope so. I think those two would work well together. Mm-hmm. Although we had Tiffy doing, you know, the Cher Horowitz, you know, makeover last week. But that's beside the point.
Her ring gear was like the main character from Clueless, Cher Horowitz.
Oh, that was her name. I've seen the movie, but I forgot her name.
Mm-hmm.
Cher Horowitz.
No relation to Barry.
No relation.
No relation to Cher.
But, yeah. Nope.
Yeah, Alicia Silverstone does not look Armenian. That's who she was named
after, though. She had a twin sister, Cher alike. What else did we talk about Raw last night? Hey, what? Did we have no Drew last night because he can't
Drew
travel?
Drew was backstage. Drew was backstage for an interview. That might have been pre-taped, though, when he kicked the monitor over.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Can we?
Yeah, I love the fact that Punk is still irritating him.
Yeah. Can we take a minute to wallow in how great the truth is?
Oh, yes. That was my other one.
Truth is.
How about those belts?
So good.
I like those. That's some sharp belts. Similar motif to the world title and the women's title.
I chuckled when he called Triple H Tommaso Ciampa. Uh-huh. That kind of crack. I thought he was a magician. Yeah, and then when Tommaso came out, it was like, "Hey, it's Triple H." I was like, oh, "I love you, Truth." And what was the point last night?
I do like the new belts.
Seriously, yes. What was the point though last night of having three baby faces going after to fight the fourth baby faces?
Because they don't have any heel tag teams.
AJ.
Yeah, the only heel tag team they got is the Judgment Day.
Yeah.
Well, they need to find some.
Finn and JD team up. But they need, you know what, I would like to see them turn the Creed brothers heel and put them with Gable.
Yeah.
That would work. I would like that.
That's one thing I really enjoyed last night was when they did the interview with Gable, but it was like they interrupted him training, like in the ring.
He was training
with him. Yeah. But I liked how they did that. It's not like your normal standing in front of the backdrop interview. They made it seem legit almost that he was legit.
Right.
Like training.
Right. I did like that. I've liked the vignettes that WWE is doing now. I don't even want to know what you two are laughing at right now. Because you're both having just a good old hate there.
You know.
But,
Kayfabe.
Okay.
Oh my goodness.
But yeah.
Don't sell.
We bring these guys off for serious discussions, and they're chittering like schoolgirls over here.
Right? Like schoolgirls. Look at this. Like tit mouses.
Tit mice. Yes.
I'm going to ask you
what else
for some shit.
Hey, I think we've covered everything, man.
I think so. We may have to put a stop to this before these two have a heart attack. Oh my
right?
All right, so next week, no guest. I'm
yes,
sure we'll have plenty to talk about.
We have a guest next week.
Oh, we do. We just confirmed that today. Minderz, tell everybody who our guest is next week.
We got damn right Sam Knight coming on.
Ooh, damn right Sam Knight.
Yes.
Yep, damn right Sam Knight.
Bejas. Yes, that literally
I'll
just
make
happened
sure
today. So.
Sam Knight t-shirt.
There
you
has
go. To say, I'm sure. But yeah, we got so damn we got, right Sam Knight. And then we've got some others in the works.
I've
got messages out to some people.
Week.
Oh, is that this weekend?
That's on Sunday, yeah. I don't know. I don't know about Dynamite tomorrow. I'm honest. I don't know if I'm gonna watch it tomorrow night. But damn it, I have to though before we talk about it on here. But I'll give the ruiner of all things a little bit more of my time.
I guess.
The ruiner Tony Khan is the ruiner of all things now.
He's got many names. Mr. Mm-hmm. Springtime, the ruiner of all things, Florida Tony, Tatoni. I think I just popped the wife with that one.
Well, you about got your spit take. We do have to try to get Zach back on.
Before pocket. Yes, he's got a benefit
Zach
show coming
Gruber.
Up. We're going to make sure we get him on. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I saw the advertisement.
That's not till what? June?
It's like June, I think. I think June.
Yeah.
I don't know. If we're going to go, we need to arrange a group travel because I don't know if I can make that drive myself.
Where's it
now
at?
The pocket.
Okay,
we'll
have to
figure
it out. I forget
anyway,
where it's at.
It's in Indiana somewhere.
We'll figure it out.
Yeah. We always do we not?
All right. Huh?
Well, I think we have covered everything. So, Scott says June 22nd. So, thank you for the information there. All right. So, we're going to get...
That's not going to work. I hope that's not right.
Why?
That's 01.
Ooh.
And Matt Toon.
Aren't Conley and somebody else on the poster from 01?
Yeah, it can't be
22nd. Well, Pawcade is a 01 event, apparently. It says 01 USA presents Pawcade.
Yeah, but I don't
Victor,
think it's...
Victor, Shaza, and Connolly on the banner for it. Let me see.
June
29th.
I'll believe it's 29th.
June 29th, Saturday at 7 p.m. So, yeah, it's not on the 22nd. That would have been an issue.
Yeah, because Conley, Shaza, Ben Trust, and Victor are all on the flyer.
Yeah.
Also, a guy in a very interesting mask I do not recognize.
Oh.
Let me have a look.
Oh, were we going to talk about Uncle Howdy?
We can.
We don't have to.
I mean, there's not a lot to talk about. I mean, he didn't appear. He just there was just a QR code that popped up.
Yeah, but then we also had. But then we had Eric Rowan having to pull out of those indie dates. Because due to new contractual obligations, so. And also Strowman, he's been out for a while
Strowman,
with his back. Strowman's out.
They're saying he's ready to come back.
So it could be Strowman, Rowan, and Uncle Howdy as the leader.
Dallas.
Yeah.
Maybe Alexa Bliss when she comes back. You never know.
Maybe. She's not healthy, too.
Everybody that's... Yeah, well, healthy. She's healthy. Just, she might be baby ready.
Hey, right.
They have,
what is
they
she
have
right?
To
what if
Alexa
she's
back? She was already with them.
Champion. What if they bring her back next week?
I'd be okay with that.
Ready. I mean,
she should be right. That kid.
What are we gonna get though?
I want Swing Set Alexa Bliss back.
I don't. I didn't care for that one.
So have you watched the Bray documentary yet? Either Reb or Bari?
Not yet. It is on my list to do this week, though. I think I'm finally
ready. Okay.
Not yet.
All right. AJ and I still won't talk about it then.
Okay. Hopefully by next week we can talk about it.
The last 20 minutes of that are going to gut you. Fair warning.
Yep. Oh, I'm sure. All right. Well,
let's get out of here. I'm hungry for this week.
Yes. Join us tomorrow for the 0-1 shootout. We're going to be joined by the powder cake Jimmy Carrot for, what, the 18th time with us?
Fifth.
But he made the announcement. He's him and B.A. Malkin in an I Quit match at War Games on May 4th. So we're going to talk all about that. Then,
you're also going to talk about that.
Hang on. Everybody talked at once. All three of you are talking at the same time. Minderz first.
I said, yeah, AJ, you know how I feel about this I Quit match coming up.
And I said, we're also going to have to talk about that crazy dive he did during that four-way at 0-1 in Terre Haute on Saturday.
Oh, yeah. The big moonsault off the bleachers.
Yeah.
I haven't watched the video yet.
Oh, spoiler alert.
Yep. Yay.
Well, I sent you the link, so it's there when you're ready for
it.
It's really on you. I'll watch it before almost a week.
I'll watch it before tomorrow.
Okay. I'm going to take Clown Tony down. It's kind of terrifying.
Yeah, no, I've been having to look at this guy in my corner all night.
Well, that's not much better, but okay.
That's Mr. This is Mr. Springtime.
Out of here. We're rambling.
Yeah.
All right.
Let's go.
Yeah, I like that one better.
All right. There we go. All right. So until next week, boys, thank you for helping us out with this one. There was a lot to talk about, so I'm glad we had some extra opinions in there. But
no problem. It was fun, like always.
Yes. Yes. All right. So we will see everybody next week for Minderz, for AJ, and for Bari. This is Reb. Life is hard. Work stiff. We'll see you guys next week. And oh, by the way.
Thanks, guys.